Hi guys, welcome to Real to Real. I know you're thinking this isn't when we normally do Real to Real. That's okay, because we're doing a special Star Wars podcast. Mm-hmm. So today we're reviewing Rogue One, A Star Wars Story. Yes. So Chris, I see you super excited over there. Do you want to give us a little bit of a plot summary?
For the Rebellion, I'll do anything. So Rogue One takes place right before Episode 4, New Hope, the one that came out in 77. And it is about how the Rebellion, how Leia got the plans to the Death Star when they were on the Corellian Corvette in the beginning of the movie, of episode four of New Hope. And so the movie is like straight out of the credits to...
Yeah, the movie fills in the opening crawl to episode four. A group of rebels have won their first victory against the Galactic Empire, so it's the story of them winning that first victory, and then it's the story of how the Rebel spies, who was doing the Death Star plans, stole those Rebel plans, or stole the Death Star plans, and then how they're broadcast back so they actually get to the Rebels on Yavin 4.
Causing the Death Star to eventually blow up, and this is how they got the Death Star plans.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's personally, I thought the movie was really good.
Yes.
We'll go more into that in a moment, but first, let's take a look at that trailer.
Is coming undone. Imperial flags reign across the galaxy.
Can you be trusted without your shackles?
Let's just get this over with, shall we?
We have a mission for you. A major weapons test is imminent. We need to know how to destroy it.
If you're really doing this, I want to help.
Good.
Good. I've been recruiting for the Rebellion for a long time.
You destroyed our home!
I fight the Empire now.
I fear nothing. All is as the Force wills it.
The captain says you are a friend. I will not kill you.
Thanks.
There isn't much time.
Every day they grow stronger.
There is a 97.6% chance of failure.
He means well.
This is our chance. Are you with me?
All the way.
Vader! Okay, so welcome back, guys. This is, again, our Rogue One review. I'm Travis Hansen.
I'm Kaylee McKee.
Nate Berg.
And I'm Chris Rose.
All right, so while the trailer was going, we actually were having this conversation. Fun fact slash disrespectful fact to the director. When they were creating the trailer, they flat out told Gareth Edwards they wanted the beautiful shots. Didn't matter if it was going to go into the movie or not.
Mm-hmm.
And this obviously brings up some tension, and we're all talking about it. So I'm going to let Nate and Chris jump into it first.
Mine was more on the plot as a whole, but definitely are a few shots in here that were never used. There was a particular shot of the stormtroopers escorting two orange-suited rebel pilots on probably Jeddah, it looks like, and Jyn sees them. That scene definitely did not make the final movie, which is slightly for the worst, but where are the rebels even at in that scene? I can see why they cut it, maybe, but...
I'm telling you, there's got to be an alternate cut of this movie.
Somewhere.
Yeah.
Agreed.
This isn't like... This can't be like Suicide Squad bad or jumbled or like as disorganized, but there's an alternate cut of this movie somewhere.
Somebody Usually, but somebody when publishing the movie forgot to put a scene in, because there's supposed to be a scene between you see Jin introduced in the prison, and then you see Jin in the prison van. Where's the scene between those where we learn who she is, what she's doing, why she is, learn her character? That scene's missing, and that hurts the movie a ton.
There's that, and also the whole Saw Gerrera part was, you know, Forrest Whitaker's character is heavily shown in the trailers,
yeah.
in the clips, and when you get him in the movie, you get none of what he's talking about in any of the trailers.
Mm-hmm.
It is almost a completely different portrayal of a character.
Right. Yeah.
And, again, like you said, this also hurts the movie.
Mm-hmm.
However, some of these shots are incredible, and I still like it, even though they're not in the movie.
Don't get the wrong sense. We liked the movie.
Yes,
we did. Liked it.
Disappointing.
We're just confused by the marketing.
We're very confused.
Mm-hmm.
We'll talk about that later. Right now...
Yeah. So right now we are going to transition slightly into cinematography.
Oh, you're still keying into that, so...
Nate, again, I'm jumping back to you. Sorry, guys. I will get back to you in a moment.
It's okay.
This movie definitely had really good cinematography. One thing it did that we haven't seen as much of in Star Wars is really good scale shots. The Star Destroyer, or the Vindicator class, or whatever the small one is, against the Death Star, that kind of thing. And also seeing AT-ATs from the ground looking up, something they could not do with the puppets in Episode 5 originally, and now they've gone back in CGI and really given us an impressive sense of AT-ATs, even though they're a construction version, AT-ATs from the ground. So, and that was definitely a lot of other just really good shots, kind of even this shot of, a lot of shots are just really, a lot of smart cinematography in this film, simple, but to the point, not criminally bad. But
It's something that Gareth Edwards does great.
Yeah.
I feel like what they did a lot is they filmed on location. It was location, 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 which made everything so much more real, and you could really understand where you were.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
And I just...
My thing with the cinematography, I've seen this movie 8 times, and seeing a movie 8 times changes a man, okay? With me, I know that Gareth Edwards, I've seen Godzilla. He goes for the documentary style of filmmaking, but to me, there were just, like, times where I feel like handheld cinematography that he uses so often wasn't necessary at some points in the movie. I can't really name which ones, because...
There were so many, but
mm-hmm. since that's a problem in action movies a lot too, so I'm much more paranoid about that too.
But it doesn't overuse it though. I'm not going to do it like a movie that I've ranted about on a reel-to-reel before. Oh, way overusing handheld in places where it doesn't belong. But another thing he did, Gareth Edwards is good at using the tools he has. The only thing is he really did not abuse low depth of field. And that's something that you see in the old films, is even in the prequels as well, is they always keep their shot. They always keep their apertures nice and clamped down. Keep a lot of things in focus. Let kind of the lighting and the viewer decide where to look. Same thing here, and I love that because unlike say Arrival, where you're confused half the time because everything's out of focus, it works really, really well.
With that in mind, actually, now I'm going to jump into CGI with you.
Oh, CGI was beautiful. You felt like it was real. It could have been real. It was real for the majority of us.
Right.
And it was just so cool to see how big the AT-ATs were and how just enormous the starships were. And you just never, in the past movies, you never truly grasped the massive size of this through the CGI they had. But this is just amazing and flawless. And I loved it.
Best blending of real and CGI we've seen in the Star Wars movie yet. They didn't abuse it like the prequels did, but taking what Episode 8 did to another level. A little bit of CGI sets and real stuff, but then carefully bringing in the real world just enough to anchor us.
Yeah.
It just worked perfectly.
They're using CGI how it should be used.
Yes.
Right.
On location.
To blend cinematography and CGI together, just for a second, the last 30 or so minutes of this movie sets the standard for space battles. From this moment forward, Episode 8 has to top this, or maybe it won't. But this, the space battle in this movie, the battle in general, is like just makes the whole battle is like the way it's shot, the way it's all animated, just makes it feel more important. Because when it came out of the theater, like the first two or three times, I'm like, The Battle of Scarif is the most important battle in Galactic Civil War history.
Yeah.
I don't care about Yavin. I don't care about Hoth. I don't care about Endor. If Scarif failed, it was over. Yeah.
It's the midway moment.
It dwarfs any other battle except for maybe even Hoth.
Right.
Mm. Yeah. And there's in one shot, we're talking CGI, this is almost perfect, is the shot where you have the X-Wings are going through the shield barrier.
Yes.
And
oh my gosh.
Two pilots don't make it in time by the time they shut down the shield gate. Mm-hmm. One pulls up in time, the other one skids like he's on ice.
His nose does.
And his ship just explodes.
Yeah.
And that's just incredible in my opinion. And the CGI complemented that scene altogether.
And we have to, if we're talking CGI, we also have to address the elephant, Tarkin. And
Tarkin. Yeah. All right, let's talk about it.
I'm probably one of the few in this room who's a big fan of seeing Tarkin back on the screen again. Considering Crusher,
When I first saw it, I'm like, this looks pretty real. All right, I know Peter Cushing is dead. Where does it go wrong? Where is this CGI going wrong? Because I knew, a lot of people have a problem with CGI. I didn't much have a problem with Tarkin. It looked real enough.
Mm-hmm.
It looked real enough. And I feel like you're going to hear that a lot. I feel like it was enough to convince me, okay, that is Tarkin.
Mm. Yeah. I think the problem is, though, there was definitely Uncanny Valley issues. There's always going to be that you can't quite get real enough problem.
Right.
It wasn't Polar Express bad, but it was definitely not 100%.
Right.
And the way I always adjust that is, why didn't they go back? One thing the prequels did more better would be have him appear as a hologram about half those shots, and people wouldn't complain nearly as much because
I feel like
you can hide a hologram, can be a CGI dude, it's going to be a CGI dude anyways, and we can't see him and save the introduction of him until right at the end of the movie and make it really special to see Tarkin in the flesh.
Right.
You don't have anything you want to add to that part?
No, I'm lost.
All right, well, then I'm going to jump in and steal your segment then.
All right.
My issue, though, with the idea of having Tarkin be a hologram instead of being a real person is in all the expanded universe and all the current canon, all they talk about is it's Tarkin is the one in control of the Death Star project.
Yeah.
We don't even know about Krennic, who we'll talk about later.
Exactly.
We don't know anything about him until this movie.
Mm-hmm.
So with the idea of him not being there in the flesh to supervise this project,
well,
and have him only supervise
on the Death Star, though. Perhaps he's in art.
There's two scenes where he's on the Death Star. There's a few scenes where he's on his own flagship.
And I would have potentially had those be done.
In that case, then you're
into work at that point. So.
Yeah, do the hologram that way.
But yeah, when he's introduced, we first see him on the bridge of the Death Star.
Yeah.
So we get that really
Which
special
that,
shot
that
towards
that
the end
shot
of the film.
Is, that
yeah.
is a great shot.
That was a pretty spectacular shot.
So with us already talking about characters, then why don't we?
Yes.
Why don't we transition? We got to make a quick halt though and go into Catalyst.
Yes,
yeah.
Catalyst, the prequel novel to Rogue One, a Star Wars story, which follows the Erso family. I think the book took place a year before the Clone Wars ended, right?
It was a year after it started.
It was a year after
it
started.
Like the first two chapters cover strictly Clone Wars.
Right. So it follows Jyn Erso, Galen and Lyra Erso, who are Jyn Erso's parents that you see at the beginning of Rogue One.
Mm-hmm.
And it follows and the whole book just goes about how the Empire is manipulating Galen, and Lyra is trying to, steer him towards good, because Galen's like, I don't know what's real anymore, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And
he struggles throughout the whole novel up until about the last few chapters. He doesn't believe that the Empire is evil.
And how that complements Galen's character is that scene where he's a hologram, where he recorded that message for Jyn. And that's how they knew that the Death Star reactor was unstable. So it makes it more impactful, that scene, the book, is how Galen was a guy who wanted to study kyber crystals in order to provide a more sustainable means of energy, but then the Empire wanted to use that research for the Death Star, and he's just so, and in that hologram scene, he's just, you could see Mads Mikkelsen is such a great actor, you could feel that he was broken. that he was such a broken man, that all of his research, that all of his dreams just were crushed by the Empire. And that's how Jin was like emotionally broken down, because she knows how much Galen cared. And then...
Well, and that's the issue, is because a lot of people who I've talked to, my parents in particular, said I didn't feel a connection with these characters. Mm-hmm. I don't know why we should care about the fact that the little girl was left on the planet, why she grew up to become like a soldier.
No,
and
no.
This book sets it up so well. It gives you reason to either like, in my case, I love Krennic, or despise him. He is a snake oil salesman, is the only way I can describe it. A used car salesman. He's the one who then turns around and says, you know, Galen, you know, you really should come work on this project. I mean, you don't have to, you know, I shouldn't even brought it up. Gets the guy interested.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Tells him that what the laser is going to be used for isn't a laser, but as an energy, renewable energy for planets that are third world. You know, he's manipulating the man.
Right.
Meanwhile, he knows the entire time what I'm going to do with this is turn it into a planet killer.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And these guys, they even talk about in the book how they're best friends from the beginning.
Right.
They've known each other since college. They're college friends.
Like us.
And Krennic, like us. Except for none of us will betray the other ones, right? Right?
Kaylee? We're on the light side here. It's you two I'm worried about.
Wow.
With that in mind,
I guess we should let's touch on the other characters real quick.
We should.
Yeah, let's bounce on the characters.
Yeah. Let's start off with Jin.
She's
my favorite. She was that little girl, the little girl that you saw that was just broken. Her parents got taken away from her. Dad got taken away from her when she was a child, and she was taken and hidden by Saw. And
when exactly hidden? She was trained by Saw.
Well, I mean, he hid her away from the Empire.
He hid her away from the Empire. And then trained by him.
Yeah.
And just seeing that and living with that knowledge that your father is creating this, but not necessarily having that, you know, figuring out your father had created this.
Yes.
And him telling her that, yeah, this is what it is and this is how you can destroy it. I did this, I feel terrible, it's going to hurt a lot of people, but you can stop it.
The novelization touches on what she said, though, perfectly, where she is this whole time believing her father has joined the Empire, willingly joined the Empire.
Yeah. Right.
You know, so, yeah, that's what you just said is exactly.
And I think the problem is, if you haven't read the book, her arc moves more like we don't even know her at the first. We kind of, okay, she's just weird, did that. Suddenly she's kind of caring, and then something else, and suddenly she's this epic hero kind of, and her arc isn't a nice smooth, like I said, where's that deleted scene that would progress her,
right.
Yeah.
Build her in, give us a reason to care about her and know her, and then we do it. It's,
yeah.
Prison scenes are so fantastic.
Yep.
Guardians of the Galaxy, whatever else.
But Guardians of the Galaxy in particular.
Shawshank Redemption. Yeah. Shawshank Redemption, that whole.
Cassian Andor.
Yes.
Diego Luna. When you're first introduced to Cassian, immediately just changes the whole dynamic.
Mm-hmm.
It changes the whole dynamic, because he shoots the guy in the back straight up.
Yeah. Then
hardly bats an eye.
It just shows how not even the rebels were clean cut. They're not the good guys. Mm-hmm. They are in a gray area at all times.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, and then like what Nate said, how like arcs aren't as smooth.
Yeah.
And like, he just like start, like, okay, he starts morally gray. He's morally gray, and then... Okay.
Chris, hold that thought. We're going to jump quickly to a PSA on healthy eating.
Be right back.
Yep.
Ready? There we go.
Look at that.
Leftover kidney failure. All right.
Excellent choice, my good sir. And what about you?
I'll have the brain aneurysm with some baba beans and a nice Chianti.
Oh, no way! Dr. Tooth Decay? Oh, Diet Mountain Memory Loss? I can't remember the last time that I had this.
Pumpkin Spice Heart Attack? Pumpkin Spice Heart Attack.
cherry cancer. Nice.
From here.
Hey guys, welcome back. Again, this is our reel-to-reel edition of Rogue One, a Star Wars story. We are the Nerd Collective, and we're coming back into our characters again.
Yeah. I'll try to touch quick-ish on the buddy rogue pair. I don't really have a good name for what they are.
The Force Brothers,
I suppose. Baze. The name's quick here.
Guardians of the Will.
Baze Malbus and Shirut Imwe. I liked both of them to an extent, but they definitely were imperfect, like a lot of the characters. Shirut in particular is probably the best Force user we've seen introduced the story since Yoda was introduced in Episode 5. Episode 5 in, 81? So, no, it's lower than that. It's down. That definitely is kind of sad and awesome. I kind of hate him a little bit because why wasn't Yoda that cool? Why wasn't any other character in the prequels that cool? But he shows us truly what a good Force user looks like, and that they're the trusting the Force ideas and being comfortable but also being using the Force to help make them really powerful, even if they're not a wholly trained Force user.
I'm starting to wonder, though, maybe the reason why that we saw this guy be such a cool character, best Force user ever. He's not even a Jedi. He doesn't know how to use the Force. He just worships it like it's a religion.
He's at one with the Force, and it's able to feel it moving around him and use that to his advantage, which is
like so he's Force sensitive, but he can't use Force lightning kind of level.
Yeah,
my thing.
He acts the way.
My thing with Chirrut, I don't think he was used to his full potential. I feel like
you can argue that. Yeah,
I feel like he's not. He can't manipulate the Force in any dramatic way. But he can sense things.
Channel.
It's like he can sense things in the next room.
Channel it. Oh.
He can channel the force.
He can channel the Force. He just can't use it in a dramatic way.
Pinpoint.
Yeah. That just leads me to wonder because this is a shameless plug. I'm sorry for Episode 8, but The Last Jedi is the name of the next Star Wars movie, which leads me to wonder if something happens and say Rey and Luke are both killed off, is it possible to get more Force wielders? Like Chirrut.
Yeah.
Yes. He's not the last Jedi.
Or just seeing a Force user, like Rey become a Force user who actually is at one with the Force and being an intelligent and incredible like the Jedi were
but
supposed to be, never really became. Like Luke was in 6 versus what?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody like
exactly.
Obi-Wan was in 3. So
maybe we're going to see less of the Jedi be what we've seen in the prequels and
dancing.
More spiritual.
Weird dancing.
Wizards.
Wizards, I suppose. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
So on to the next
characters.
So wizards.
Want to base it all?
They're not wizards.
Yeah, let's
touch
base.
Base is just kind
of not
he was there as small support as much as anything.
Yeah.
My only disappointment with him was also with sure. I wish they had died more nobly. I definitely wish their deaths had felt more either emotionally impactful or just more right. I wish they
would
have been standing on the beach together at the end scene.
That, that's too cheesy.
The bartender at my work made the comment that he believes what should have happened was. Chirrut should have died using the Force. Instead of walking out onto the beach, he should have just been able to sit right in that little bunker that he was at, put out his hand, and the switch would have flipped off, unjamming the communications, and then boom, big explosion, he dies nobly.
Yeah.
That just gave me chills. I would have loved to see that, but we didn't.
Anything
else?
My thing with Baze, if you're going to complain that nobody had an arc, Baze is going to be your primal example.
Yeah.
Because all we know is that he was the most devoted guardian of any of the Guardians of the Wills on Jeddah.
Yep.
And then the Empire takes away the temple. I'm drawing a blank. I've seen the movie 8 times. then the Empire takes away the temple, and then he's just like, well, screw it. There's nothing to live for anymore. So then he's constantly picking at Chirrut.
I did like, though, that he used the chant at the end, though, as he's picking off
baddies. I like how he said it backwards.
Chirrut
says, I am one with the Force is with me. Baze says, the Force is with me, and I am one with the Force. So it would have been cool if Chirrut was actually saying it wrong the whole time, and Baze was only correcting him.
Yeah.
Oh no.
He's the most devout of our order. That's why he gets the line right.
So, right. Saw Gerrera, huh?
Anything?
Yeah. Do we want to quickly touch on Saw?
Or anybody else we missed out? Kind of anybody other characters from
Oh, the new droid.
K2SO.
K2SO. Yes. Yeah. All right. Alan, so what people think is the best part of the movie.
He was up there for me, but he wasn't the best.
The best character in the. I gotta go with Jen. Jen
had filled his role. I'm
the one who loves Krennic, apparently.
Yes.
So we should probably then move on to the most important part of this podcast, not our ratings.
That
comes later.
Not yet.
How does this fit into the rest of the Star Wars universe?
Perfectly.
Yeah.
Yes. It did. Okay.
Like a glove.
Before the canon wipe of 2013, the great canon wipe of 2013, as I like to call it, the whole every book that came out just messed up with. This messed with the canon, and then just confused because there were six different layers of canon before the canon wipe. This would have been.
Let's get out of this inception. There are layers and layers and layers. But let's just.
That's kind of what Disney.
This one fits perfectly.
Put it on the table. What'd you think of it?
So, I'm saying 5.
Group rating 5.
5.
We're giving this 5 out of 5.
Too much deliberation and debate. We give it a 5.
There's no debate.
5.
I like that some were disappointed with this movie. I'll be honest with you. It was far from perfect, but it was what I expected. I don't know if people were expecting Godfather or Apocalypse Now or something, but.
Oh, I can only imagine a Star Wars Godfather. Yeah.
With the bar that Star Wars has set, where you either have the prequels and you've got
you've got
4, 5, and 6.
Yeah.
Right where you wanted it to be.
Exactly.
So.
Well, and the thing I like the most about this, why I'm giving it the 5 out of 5 rating, is, again, it's the Battle of Scarif. And at the very end, with Darth Vader and the corridor.
The most important battle I've ever seen in Star Wars.
Beautifully edited shot.
This movie, then, as we said in our predictions, this starts about roughly anywhere between a day and a couple hours before New Hope.
No,
it's got 10
minutes.
When
you factor hyperspace,
yeah.
Yes. That.
Oh, so, this movie was so good. With that in mind, we all gave it a glowing review.
Go see it.
Yet.
If you haven't seen it, why are you still watching this? Go out and see it.
Exactly.
This is Hennepin Technical College's Reel to Reel. I'm Travis Hansen.
I'm Kaylee McKee.
Nate Berg.
I'm Chris Rose.
I guess we're not leaving yet.
I guess we're not.
Nobody started the timer on us, so.
So. I guess because we're not leaving, we're going to go back into what we were talking about before. And merchandising.
Merchandising. You got to see.
Hashtag sold out.
K Jewelers, they have these really cute bracelets that says, I love you, and that says, I know. And I just thought that was really sweet.
Shameless plug.
I love you. All right. And I was also admiring Travis's t-shirt because Van Gogh is...
I don't know if you can
wonderful.
See that.
I don't know if you can see that or not.
I guess now we're leaving.
But we're just circling the drain, and let's just...
Thanks so much for joining us today. I'm sorry it's in the middle of your afternoon. Hope you have a great rest of your evening. May the Force be with you, and get us off the screen, Ridge, if you know what's good for you.